Shall I start?
Yep.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Search and Matching virtual workshop, virtual seminar. Today, we are honored to have Randy, the father of all search and matching workshops, to present his work, or his research agenda, Frictional Capital Markets, A New Frontier. Before we start the seminar, Pierre will make an announcement about an upcoming workshop.
Hi, everyone, and thanks, Xin. Very quickly, I would like to announce a new workshop that will take place on August 28th. It's a workshop on liquidity in fixed income OTC markets during the early weeks of the COVID-19 crisis. It's a second workshop that's hosted by the Search and Matching Macro and Finance Group. The workshop is going to be made up of six empirical papers by leading scholars in the field. The goal is going to be to take stock on empirical evidence on how OTC market function during the early weeks of the COVID crisis. We believe that we hope that the empirical evidence is going to be of great interest to anyone working on a search and matching model of OTC markets because it offers unique insights on how those OTC markets function under stress and what has been the impact of pretty unconventional monetary policy in those markets. So that's it. It's going to be on August 28th. Please join if you're interested. Without further ado, I'll pass the mic to Randy.
Okay. Today, we're very honored to have many great panelists for Randy's talk. For the rest of us, if you have questions during Randy's talk, you can ask questions in a Q&A window. And Randy's co-author, Wei Cui from UCL and Yu Zhu from Bank of Canada will try to answer them. Or you can raise your hand after Randy's talk during the 15-minute Q&A session. Okay. So now, Randy, I'll give the screen to you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'm going to show you my slides. I'm not going to show you my picture because I don't know how to do it. The title of the talk, What the New Frontier Will Be Explained, the title of the paper we're actually
Randy,
going to present.
We cannot see your screen yet.
Oh. Oh, okay, hang on.
Share your screen.
Yep, I can try to do that. If I only knew how. Yep, I can do it now. Looking good?
Yep.
Okay, so my co-authors are listed on the title page there. It's great fun and honor and educational experience to be presenting in this workshop. So the reason I call it a new frontier for search-based economics is there's been quite a bit of recent work, and I've listed lots of names there. If I'm missing any, please let me know, of people who work on capital reallocation. And I think the tools of search theory are ideal for these applications. So in addition to the traditional applications in labor, marriage markets, housing, monetary economics, and finance, I think capital reallocation is really a new area where we can apply our tools. Is both an important area and it fits very well with what we do. We're not the first to push this, of course, but we're not the first to consider it. And again, I'll list the names there. But I think we do some things different. In particular, we focus on liquidity to a great extent. So here's a couple of general observations. As we see it, there's really
Randy,
two keys. Yes?
Sorry to interrupt. Could you go full screen?
Okay.
You can just click.
How's that?
Yeah, that's fine. Good. And move the mouse to the, yeah, okay, that's fine, great.
Will you stop bugging me? Sorry. Is that okay?
Perfect, thanks.
Okay, so the two keys to efficient output and growth are capital accumulation and capital reallocation. We have to get, you know, the investment decision right over time to build capital, but we also have to allocate the capital properly, getting into the hands of those best able to use it. Traditional macro is focused only on capital accumulation, but now two is in the spotlight, especially in the work by the authors listed above. I also want to emphasize that as in any asset market, there's feedback from one to two and vice versa. So Lagos Zhang emphasized this recently and attribute some of the ideas to Harris and Krebs. But you know, it's obvious if it's easier to reallocate capital, you may want to invest more in the primary market. Then again, you may want to invest less. So there's important interactions between these primary and secondary trading arrangements. You know, it's like if it's easier to sell a house, you're more inclined to buy a house. So we'll come back to that. But these are general observations. Here's some particular observations from the literature. So first off, many authors have documented that reallocation, by which we mean trade and secondhand capital, is sizable. If you just look at a narrow part of the data, at least one third of aggregate capital expenditures come from capital expenditures on used stuff. I say conservatively in this bullet point because that's neglecting non-traded firm, non-publicly traded firms. It's neglecting small firms, and it's not even including rentals, only purchases. So capital reallocation is big. Now, some early work in this area by Antonella, it's very interesting, and it's one of the applications that led me to think this is an important area. He finds models of capital with search better fit the facts and entail more interesting propagations than similar models without search. I'm also persuaded by a work of Honer. I don't know his first name, he's a Rashito student, but I saw his early work in his dissertation, where he examines vacancies for commercial real estate and argues they resemble unemployment data in many interesting dimensions, suggesting that if search is relevant for thinking about the labor market, it seems equally relevant for thinking about capital markets. He also documents a substantial price dispersion inconsistent with Walrasian complete frictionless markets. Gavaza, in a series of papers focusing on a particular industry, the airline industry, makes several points. First, used capital sales are three times new sales. Prices tend to vary inversely with search time. Market tightness affects trading frequency, and again, there's substantial price dispersion. So these were all ideas in the literature that led me to think this is an interesting area to work on. In particular, there are several frictions in the secondhand capital market that makes a search-based approach quite natural. Matching is non-trivial, in part due to specificity. So capital tends to be put in place and designed for the use of that producer, and it's maybe not that easy to find the capital you need when you're trying to buy it, and it's not that easy to sell the capital if it's been specialized. I've already mentioned prices is non-Walrasian. To a large extent, these are definitely over-the-counter markets. You need to find a counterparty, and prices are determined by the parties in the trade. Liquidity matters for the usual reasons. I'll come back to that. There's various other information problems. Obviously, adverse selection is a big deal. We're going to downplay that in this presentation, but in principle, it's an important thing. So we want to build models, if you will, a framework to capture some of these frictions, as many as deemed interesting. We also want to account for the facts documented by various authors. And I've listed some of the facts here. Capital mismatch seems kind of cyclical. These other variables, reallocation as a share of total capital expenditure and the price of used capital seem pro-cyclical. And it's not trivial to account for all of these facts in addition to your standard business cycle facts. So we think that's an interesting challenge, both quantitatively and qualitatively. We also think the models we're going to talk about today are fascinating, and I hope you share that sentiment to some extent. So first, this is quite interesting to me, being an elder statesman, or at least an elder person. The equilibrium in these models, they resemble old-fangled macro models, like, you know, the stuff in textbooks from the 60s, or even some textbooks today. But we believe they have a legitimate claim to micro foundations. They can rationalize interesting policy discussions that have not been derived from theory, but more, I don't know, from introspection. They can also talk about limitations to those policies and why they might not be a good idea. Interestingly, as in the work of most people in this workshop, the policy implications depend on micro details. for example, bargaining power can dramatically affect the implications for monetary policy on investment, which is something you would never notice if you didn't use a search-based approach. Also, it's interesting to me, at least, that these models feature liquidity demand by firms, not just households. I want you to think Kiyotaki Moore versus Kiyotaki Wright. Kiyotaki Moore had some things very nicely done, especially in terms of big ideas. But more important, or more interestingly to me at least, it's much easier to model the demand for liquidity by firms and households. Maybe I'll come back to that. But I think we have relatively solid micro foundations. And of course, these models integrate key elements of search and dynamic GE theory. In particular, a special case of our model would be Hansen's classic 1985 real business cycle paper. But it's extended to have idiosyncratic shocks to firms and frictional markets where firms trade capital. So it's sort of a generalization of standard real business cycle theory, a monetary generalization in particular, without reduced form devices like cash in advance. Okay, so with the current project, you know, part of a larger research agenda, we want to present some new facts. I'll briefly talk about facts. These facts concern capital reallocation and liquidity. We want to continue developing the framework. This in some sense integrates earlier work by Yuzu and me and Sylvia with earlier work by Wei. And in this paper, we want to deviate from what I've done in some previous work. We're going to use standard specifications like Cobb-Douglas constant returns to scale production. We also want to go beyond some of at least my earlier work where we just use IID shocks to productivity. We want to consider persistence. It's natural and it's interesting, but we want to try to do so without sacrificing tractability so we can still prove theorems and not just look at computer output. We also want to study dynamics more seriously than at least some of the past work that I've done. We don't want to just compare steady states. We want to think about impulse response functions. And maybe the key substantive issue is we want a model of both types of reallocation. The first type being a merger or an acquisition where one firm buys out the other one. The other being a partial buyout where the firm purchases some capital from a counterparty, not necessarily all of it. And we think there's interesting facts related to those types of reallocation. We want to model it theoretically and empirically. Questions?
Yeah, this is Xu Yang. I do have a question about this IID shocks.
Yeah.
I understand it's for an analytical tractability, but since you're actually looking at capital relocation, I guess probably with the data, persistent shocks would generate a very different patterns of capital relocation than IID shocks.
That's exactly why we want to go beyond the IID shocks.
Yeah,
that would be a critique of the earlier work. We're going to move beyond that. Although today I'll talk about IID shocks for part of the presentation to illustrate some theoretical points, but definitely we agree with that.
Yeah, because with the IID shocks, if they, you know, good productivity is going to be gone tomorrow, why would you want to buy this used capital?
Yeah, we'll talk about that, but I agree with you.
Could I ask a question at this point too?
Yes, John.
Hi, good afternoon, good morning. If a firm buys up another firm, as in an acquisition, but the acquired firm is still doing the same production, both before and after, is that reallocation or is that just simply something to do with financial engineering?
Well, I don't think we have a lot to say about industrial organization in terms of corporate structure, really. What we're going to do here is just think about the allocation in terms of who gets the capital. And, you know, it'll be more clear when you see the equations, but I don't really have a lot to say about that. You know, the other firm, especially with IID shocks, if you're low productivity and you meet somebody in this OTC market, you might offload all your capital. The next period in the primary market, you might start again because you're looking towards a new shock.
Just to make sense of your last two bullets, is it the case the difference between the two is that in one case, one firm's exit, and in that case, the firm might not exit, the one that is whose capital is being sold?
It's not so much the exit, they will produce in the next period.
And in
but
one
they
case
do a longer run, and that depends on details.
But the difference between a merger and a purchase, some capital is whether the merged firm still active or not. Is that correct?
Right, right. Our firm that gets taken over in the sense that it offloads all its capital will not be producing in that period. That firm could re-enter in the future because, you know, there's free entry and anybody can start a firm.
It's about the corner only.
Yeah, it's very much about a corner. So this paper is all about corner solutions. That's one thing we'll emphasize below. Thanks for the
suggestion. Just going back to John's question, I mean, you're here focusing on the reallocation of physical capital, but you know, at this abstract level, maybe we could think about reallocation of other kind of capital, such as organizational capital. That would be
agreed.
One way to firm merge, and the other one continue production.
Yeah, I agree.
But maybe
I'm particularly interested in things like buying the customer base of another firm. But this paper is not going to address that.
Yeah, so that would be another form of intangible.
Let me forge ahead. I only have 30 slides, ignoring the title page. So I think I'll get through all of this, but let me also do this, not spend much time on the data, but we want to emphasize a couple of points, and the paper is going to go into much detail here. We have CompuStat data on acquisitions and also partial sales of property, plant, and equipment and total capital expenditures. We're going to focus on these two variables, the variable R, which is reallocation as a share of total capital expenditure, and P, which is partial sales over total reallocation. Just for your information, mergers where one firm buys all the capital of the other is about 2/3 of reallocation, with 1/3 being partial sales.
Randy, what is total capital expenditures?
It's expenditures on capital in total.
So it's a gross or a net? I mean, is it the difference between the first two?
I think it is all expenditures by firms with buying capital, whether it be, you know, you buy a new building or you buy a used building. In addition to buildings, it includes equipment, the trucks, et cetera. And the question in these data, we know how much firms from CompuStat are spending on these capital purchases. We're also going to break it down and how much they spend according to buying out some other firm and how much they spend by partially buying out the other firm. Is that a good answer? Is that sufficient?
Yes, thank you.
I had a question that's the same as Brianna asked in the Q&A. Where does renting enter in here?
It's interesting. You can interpret our model as purchases or rentals to some extent, and I'll talk about that a bit later.
And in the data?
I think this data does not have rentals. This data has purchases, which is a deficiency in the data, obviously. What we care about from the economic point of view is who gets the capital, whether you buy it or rent it. Again, economic theory, as far as I know, doesn't have a lot to say about purchases versus rentals. That's a very interesting question that we're not going to talk about it much today.
This data does have a lease. So that's kind of...
Could be. Let me move on quickly because I don't want to get bogged down on this. So a very, very brief description of the data. What we're trying to argue is that reallocation is affected by the cost of liquidity. It's one of the main focuses of this project. And I want people to understand something. In reality, there's a spectrum of assets from your human capital to, you know, antique furniture, things which are not that liquid, moving up to things like corporate bonds, T-bills, checking accounts, currency. And all these different assets have different liquidity in principle and presumably different rates of return. If two assets are going to be held in equilibrium and one's more liquid, it better not have a higher rate of return or it would dominate. This is holding risk constant. So in the spirit of macroeconomics, we're going to think about two assets here. There's a sense of aggregation is part of the plan. We're going to think about capital, which is not particularly liquid, and then money-like assets. So in the data, they talk a lot about firms with holding cash. They don't really mean paper currency and coins. They might include checking accounts and instruments that are relatively easily converted to cash, say T-bills. In the model, we're going to talk about money because we want to have a two-asset model. In principle, you could have many assets. But when we say money, you know, we're going to be thinking about nominal interest rates and or inflation rates as the cost of holding these assets. And so therefore, what we refer to as the cost of liquidity here is measured by, I guess in this slide, it's the T-bill rate. You know, we've also looked at the corporate bond rates. The inflation rate is another measure. Whatever it is that costs you more to hold relatively liquid assets. And we're looking in these charts on the in the left column at the raw data, which shows that R and P, the takeovers as a share of total capital expenditure, and in the bottom P, which is partial purchases as a share of total reallocation expenditures, they move different in the raw data. The top one obviously decreased and the bottom one increasing. And we also filter, this is Hodrick Prescott, maybe it's band pass filter. These things behave differently in the short run and the long run. At high frequency data, R is increasing with the nominal interest rate, whereas P is decreasing. And we're very interested in the difference between long and short run here. So let me tell you, this is a chart, you can look at it while I talk. Our takeaway from the data, and I just don't have time to go into all the details, it seems that inflation or nominal interest rates, which tend to move together, they have one effect in the longer run and one different effect in the shorter run. But what we're thinking is higher inflation and nominal interest rates increase the cost of liquidity, which is bad for reallocation in general, but definitely is going to hurt takeovers because you may not have enough liquidity to buy all the capital. You'll be at a corner. But over the business cycle, or let's say at higher frequency, the correlation between inflation and nominal interest rates on the one hand and these reallocation variables on the other hand, we think is driven by money demand, that is credit shocks. So when credit becomes easier, then you're gonna get changes in reallocation, but you're also gonna get some inflation and higher nominal interest rates, not caused by money supply, caused by people demanding less liquidity when credit becomes easier. So that's very interesting and complicated. I'm gonna move on, and we can come back to that in the discussion at the end where my co-authors can say more. I mentioned in the introduction, we're interested in money demand by businesses or firms in addition to households. And this chart just shows you some scatter plots. The middle panel is one we're all, or mostly all familiar with, money demand by households. You can see it looks like a structural break after 1980. Nicolini and Lucas figure out that's caused by some changes in regulations and they can fix that. The left panel, that's firms holding of money. It's less than households, but you know, you can read the axis for yourself. And money demand by firms kind of looks pretty good. So we're generally interested in money demand by firms as well as capital. Let me briefly mention before I forget why I think demand for money, or more generally liquid assets by firms, is easier to model in terms of micro foundations. So the work I did with Nobu early in my so-called career and moving up towards work with Treos and Legos was always households needing liquidity. Now you want to introduce capital into those models. People have done it. But there becomes always this uncomfortable question. When people are buying consumption goods and they're using money, but there's capital in the model, I always get asked, why don't they use capital to buy their consumption? And you can address that, but you have to dance around it a little bit. Here, that question doesn't come up. This is firms buying capital. You don't get very far if you buy capital and pay for it with capital, do you? So capital here can't be a medium of exchange. It's the target of your expenditure. So I think that just, you know, cuts very quickly through that question about why is capital not a medium of exchange. This is not to say that you couldn't talk about related issues, like firms buying new capital, maybe by issuing claims against future profits. But I think it's a new perspective on this issue. I'm gonna move on. So I already mentioned this about-
On the last comment, some firms, when they merge, they use their stock as a form of payment, no?
Yeah, we're gonna have that.
Okay.
Yeah.
That will interpret as capital use. And I just, maybe it's totally second order, but.
No, it's well, I have a slide on that. And a
that
nice
bullet point. An example of capital use to buy capital or?
Yeah. Okay. Like when you buy a house, you use the house to buy the house because, you know, the home equity, that is the house itself, can be used to secure the mortgage loan. And that's true in capital markets too. So Vaza and his work talks about that in the airline industry. So we're gonna have that. Okay. What I wanna do is talk a bit about modeling here. We're still working on the quantitative results and they're coming along, I think, very, very interestingly. But I wanna talk a bit about some modeling. So in earlier work with Yu Zhu and Sylvia, we borrowed this alternating CMDM structure from Lagos Wright. It's kind of ideal because we're going to nicely, we think, say that the primary capital market corresponds to the centralized market in Lagos Wright. And the secondary market corresponds to the decentralized market in Lagos Wright, with frictions related to search and bargaining and liquidity, et cetera. And we also think it's a nice framework to use for this. As I say, it has elements of dynamic GE, so standard real business cycle theory is a special case. But in the decentralized market, it's by now well known that these specifications allow for a variety of ways to model search, matching, pricing, and liquidity. So we think it's ideal. Now, Wei, in his earlier work, we're gonna integrate what we thought about was a good idea with his ideas. We're gonna use, as I say, constant return to scale technology with capital productivity shocks. You see, in the earlier work, we used decreasing returns. Why? Going back to Burra's comment, we wanted to avoid corner solutions where one firm buys all the other firm's capital. But you know, Wei, he wanted corner solutions. He was after firms buying out a different firm. But what's interesting is when you integrate it, you're gonna get both, and Francesco stole a bit of my thunder here. We're gonna have two types of corner solutions. So if two firms meet in a decentralized over-the-counter market, the more productive one should get all the capital by constant returns. So we're gonna have that corner if liquidity is not binding in that meeting. But liquidity could be binding even after using some credit, and the higher productivity firm may not be able to buy out the lower productivity firm. So there's gonna be two types of trade in the decentralized market, characterized by stock outs where I buy all your capital and cash outs where you get all my money. In general, one of these two constraints will bind. Here's the environment. That was motivation for the big picture of what the project's about. Here's the details of the environment. Unless just some questions. Okay, good. So firms are owned by entrepreneurs here, or households, I should say. Again, we don't have a lot to say about corporate finance. So you could think of the individuals as being firm owners. We could allow them to hold shares in other firms. It won't change anything. And they're gonna face idiosyncratic shocks. The paper has aggregate shocks because we're on a macro model, but I'm gonna ignore that. And maybe until the second last slide where we talk more about aggregate shocks. So the key here is these shocks to idiosyncratic productivity of capital are realized after the centralized market closes, which implies gains from trade in this secondary market. So in the spirit of realism and also using the tools I know how to use, this decentralized secondary capital market will be over the counter market. Firms are going to meet randomly. alpha is going to be the arrival rate, and clearly capital should flow to the firm with higher productivity. Now, we're following standard growth theory. Capital produced in the centralized market at day T doesn't come online until T plus one. But standard growth theory doesn't have reallocation, so we're going to say capital produced at T can be used at T plus one, even if it's reallocated across firms in between periods.
So Randy, following on Shi Young's question, if the idiosyncratic shocks are highly persistent, does that reduce the gains from trade in the decentralized market?
Yep, because if you know your productivity is going to be high, you can buy your capital in the primary market. The gains from trade result from the noise or the short run differences in productivity.
So it's also a natural framework to look at things like learning. You get sort of a revision on your productivity or something.
Okay, I agree with that. Yeah, Burdett and I used to write down these marriage market models where we talked about shocks to the quality of the match. And then later we said, it's learning. It's not that your wife turned bad. She was always bad. You just didn't know it. So you can interpret these idiosyncratic shocks as learning. I agree. Not to speak about your wife in particular, Obik, but, you know, in general.
Or not to speak about you either.
Right, right. Moving right along, there's a timeline. You know the timeline, but let me just go through it. In this primary market, households work, consume, settle debts because there'll be some credit, adjust their portfolios, which in the baseline model is just money holdings. Firms produce using labor and capital. Government sets policy. In the secondary market, idiosyncratic shocks, bilateral meetings, and you know the routine. Let's look at some equations. What's the wealth for an agent who owns a firm and the firm has state K epsilon? K is the capital they brought into the period. And epsilon is their state of technology. Well, omega is their wealth. It's the profits they get from the firm after tax. They have the undepreciated part of the capital, one minus delta K. Real balances Z, and we subtract off debt and lump sum taxes. Where, importantly to us, because of constant returns, profit is linear in the effective capital stock, epsilon K. So basically, if you take the production function A epsilon K to one minus eta, labor to eta minus the wage bill, maximize out with respect to employment, because in this paper, the labor market is frictionless. It would be interesting to add frictional labor markets. We don't do that here. When you maximize out, your profits are actually linear in epsilon K. B is the coefficient. Of course, it depends on the wage. So that's what's going to drive a lot of results, in particular, some corner solutions. So here's the centralized market problem. As always, these are very easy. The value function for a firm, which has a certain amount of wealth, actually the value function for an agent, a household who owns a firm, the agent has wealth omega and the firm has productivity epsilon, they maximize out the utility of consumption, the disutility of employment, plus the continuation value, which is they're going to go to this decentralized market and try to reallocate capital depending on their idiosyncratic shock. And it's a Walrasian budget equation. Your consumption, that's numerare. It equals your wealth in numerare, your after-tax labor income. You have to subtract off your asset demand. So Z hat is real balances for next period. And the relative price is basically the inflation rate. Phi is the value of money in terms of goods. So phi over phi plus is inflation. And the price of capital is one. So I just subtract off K hat because like in standard growth theory, capital is the same physical object as the numeraire. This is pretty standard. The results are pretty standard. Consumption satisfies a simple equation. It's these results come in part from quasi-linear utility, as you well know. As an aside, this is the Hansen-Rogerson model. They don't have quasi-linear utility. They get quasi-linear as a reduced form from indivisible labor and employment lotteries. That works here perfectly well.
Randy, I have a clarifying question. You're using words like firms, individuals.
Yeah.
I'm confused. When people actually purchase a diversified portfolio of all the firms?
They don't need that here because of the quasi-linearity. You see that?
Well, that depends on when you actually purchase that portfolio.
Maybe.
Yeah, if the only time you can purchase the portfolio is in a centralized market, yes, I agree with you.
Yeah, that's what we've assumed.
Okay.
Okay, but no, there's something interesting to what you say, of course, as usual. Right. We assume what you said, you can purchase this portfolio of new capital and real balances in the centralized market. What he has in mind is if you're holding multiple types of capital that has different productivity in the decentralized market, that might be useful.
But that's what I mean.
Yeah, we don't have that here. Let me think about that for future. Okay, I hadn't thought about that. So this is a typical result in these kinds of models. The portfolio Z hat K hat is independent of wealth. That's because of quasi-linearity, either as a primitive assumption or in the reduced form. It depends on productivity as the solution to, this is the portfolio problem, after you plug in the budget equation into the objective function. So the cost is the first term of buying these two assets, and it's in terms of after-tax wages, because that's how you turn hours of work into numeraire, and then Greek letter up top, it gets it zeta, turns it into utility, and I got to multiply by the relative prices of real balances and capital. I already mentioned the quasi-linearity drives the fact that there's no need for diversification. Depending how you set things up, the value function is linear in wealth. And last comment, of course, this assumes an interior solution for hours worked. I put it at least for some periods, not necessarily every period, but I don't want to get into that right now. Notice one thing, you don't necessarily work for yourself. In this frictionless labor market, it's not pinned down who works for whom. So in general, labor supply by an agent is not equal to labor demand by an agent as owner of the firm. I will say no more about that. The decentralized market, okay, we have a distribution as a state variable. It's the distribution of capital, real balances, and productivity across agents, across firms. So in some versions, we've tried directed search. It obviously makes a difference. Here, it's going to be random search. So bilateral random meetings. Each agent is characterized by their capital, their liquidity in terms of cash and their productivity. And if my productivity is higher than yours, we have gained some trade. There are two constraints. And here I have to say, I get mad at Pierre Olivier Weil for lots of reasons, but here's one. He would say this model has a cash in advance constraint and a capital in advance constraint. And then I get so mad, I don't know what to do. This is the same as if I trade apples to you for bananas. I can't give you more bananas than I have, and you can't give me more apples than you have. But I don't think it's useful to call that a fruit in advance constraint. It's just a feasibility constraint in bilateral trade. So even though I get mad at Pierre Olivier for that language, I do love him dearly. And let's move on.
I don't think it should get so mad about it. It is, but it is a micro foundation for that. So what?
Now I'm mad at you too. Let's not get bogged down on nomenclature here, but Noble and I never set out to justify cash in advance in our work. This is a different framework from cash in advance theory. When I read Lukacs and Stolke, I do not see bilateral trade. Hence, there's no room for elements that are key to what we do, the arrival rate, bargaining power, limited commitment, etc. So it's a different framework. search theory is not a micro foundation for cash in advance. I don't do Walrasian markets. I mean, I do, but in some applications, I'm willing to go beyond Walrasian markets. So the cash in advance is a literature which is Walrasian, tacking on a side constraint. That's not what we're doing here. And moreover, there's credit in this model, so it's obviously not cash in advance. This goes back to earlier questions. Similar to Kiyotaki Moore, you're allowed to pay for your acquisitions, partial or total, using the capital you buy as collateral. So here we've got the debt. I'm going to buy Q units of your capital. Some of it depreciates, so I can't get a mortgage against the entire stock I'm purchasing, because it's going to depreciate. And we also have what I call the Kiyotaki Moore parameter that I like to denote by chi, indicating the haircut you take on collateralizing your purchase. Note that it's not exactly Kiyotaki Moore. In some models in that framework, you can also use existing capital. We can add that too, but we're not doing that right now. We're saying only the new capital can be used to secure the loan, and indeed potentially only part of that.
Well, and I thought this is different from Kiyotaki Moore. In the Kiyotaki Moore, the right-hand side is the value of the capital, not the quantity.
Yeah, but capital's price is one, so it's the same thing here. In the centralized market, capital is numerare. So this is the value of capital. It's not the profitability of capital, as you might see, say, in Holmstrom Tyrol. So this is, I think, similar in spirit to Kiyotaki Moore, but we're using in earlier questions it comes up, this is the net purchase of your capital, not your total capital stock. We have reasons for doing this, but note the following quickly. Even if chi equals one, you need some cash in the transaction. Because if you're sitting on capital and you sell it to me, and I'm going to use some debt up to one minus delta Q, well, you can get that amount just by sitting on the capital yourself, even if you don't use it in production. So I've got to top up this debt with some assets, with some liquidity, some payment up front. Now I see here we can almost ignore it. At the margin, you're using liquid assets to make the purchase. So we can ignore this debt in the Euler equations for asset demand. However, it's still relevant because even though it's not relevant at the margin, it's relevant on average. You get to hold, you will choose to hold fewer liquid assets because you have access to some credit, and that affects your payoff. So I don't want to go into this too much. I want to know.
Randy, just going back to the banana in advance, in our defense, what we have is a multilateral meeting technology. So there is the question of, you know, whether or not you can rent the banana from others arise, and it does not in yours because you have strictly bilateral meetings. So that's why.
Fair enough. Let me mention.
We call that a constraint.
I still don't like it, but you know that's a matter of taste, I guess. But anyway.
No, I mean, it has a lot of tractability advantage for us.
Let me mention here that this kind of looks like a rental. You see, you could sell me the capital and I could pay for it. Then in the next centralized market, I can sell it. Or you can rent me the capital and then I can use it and then give it back to you. It's the same because it's a frictionless centralized market. So giving it back to you is no different from selling it on the open market. So it's a matter of terminology, whether we consider this rental or purchase.
But Randy, can I ask you a quick question?
Yep.
Bring you back to it. So that thing you have in red there, that's because of the persistence in the productivity shock. Is that?
No.
No. Oh.
If there's, in part it is, the epsilon, of course, even with IID productivity shocks, K and Z will be degenerate. You're right about that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It'll
still be a distribution of epsilon.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So Ricardo was seeing, you know, ahead on this, and that's natural. But even so, it's key. with IAD productivity shocks, all the firms look the same in the centralized market. So they're all going to bring the same K and Z, but then they get hit with the epsilon, so they're still heterogeneity generating gains from trade. In general, if we have persistent productivity, high productivity firms will bring more capital. They might well bring more real balances too, because, you know, if the it depends on the correlation details, but in general, if there's persistent productivity shocks, higher productivity firms will bring a different portfolio in terms of capital and in terms of real balances. Still, even with IID shocks, so you get a degenerate distribution of K and Z, there's gains from trade because the epsilons. So the key here is with probability one, either the banana in advance constraint or the apple in advance constraint is going to be binding. And if the capital constraint is binding, I get all your capital. We call it a stock out or an acquisition. If the other constraint is binding, I'm going to give you all my liquid assets and even using some debt, and I will get less than your capital. We call that a cash out.
Randy?
Yes.
This is Adriano. A quick question. Hello. Can you elaborate on this assumption that you can only borrow against the reallocated capital, if I'm interpreting it correctly?
Well, you want me to justify it in terms of theory? One version of that would be, I'm trying to buy a house and you're making a loan. You can see the house I'm buying and you can value it, and we can use that to secure the loan. I may claim to have a house in Cuba or other capital somewhere. You don't know if I have it, where it is, you can't evaluate it. So that's one motivation for the assumption that you can only use as collateral the new purchases as opposed to your existing stock. Now, having said that, we can add in fact, in the paper, we probably have chi times Q. You can collateralize part of that plus chi times K. You know, you might take a haircut, but you can also use some of your stock of capital. We even have chi sub pi. So as in Holmstrom Tyrol, you can pledge part of your profits. And then we can add a bit of Kehoe-Levine credit as well for unsecured loans. We want at the margin to people, that is agents, to still demand liquidity. So doing it this way, it's absolutely clear that you're going to need some liquid assets. We can add in other forms of secured credit or unsecured credit. We don't want to drive the demand for liquidity out. So this is a kind of a quick way to get at that. Is that helpful?
I see. Yeah. Thank you. Okay.
That's all I got. So, okay. Decentralized market is surprisingly easy. Consider Kalai bargaining, but you know, you're free to substitute any mechanism you want, including Walrasian pricing. So recall that B times epsilon K is profit, and define this term. This is this delta term, we just figured out yesterday what it means. It's actually the price in terms of the capital you buy after using some credit. So you can see here in a stock out trade, I get all your capital. How much I pay is the capital I get times delta, where delta is this expression here. So it's effectively the cash or the down payment price of the new capital. In a cash out trade, I give you all my liquid assets, and the quantity of capital I get satisfies this equation. So it's surprisingly easy. You know, you basically have the closed form for the bargaining here. Nash would be slightly less tractable in terms of algebra, but you know, equally easy in terms of the substantive results. So the bargaining here is not a big problem. And again, if you were wed to Walrasian pricing for whatever reason, you could do that too. And here's the way we'll partition matching space. Oops, where did I back up? So a bilateral meeting is characterized by the two epsilons. And in this diagram, epsilon is higher than epsilon tilde. So above the 45 degree line, I'll be the epsilon firm. I'm interested in purchasing your capital. There's actually a linear frontier. You can see this downward sloping line dividing the regions AS, where there's a stock out trade, and AC, where there's a cash out trade. I don't have time to talk about efficiency very much because, you know, the hour is moving quickly. But note quickly that efficiency and equilibria are at odds here. The big gains from trade, speaking heuristically, are your epsilon is quite low, my epsilon is quite big. Right? Then there's huge gains from trade. But then I'm going to run out of cash. So the equilibrium means we're going to trade a small amount of capital because the price will be high and I don't have that much liquidity, where the social planner wants me to get all the capital. So there's a definite tension between this over-the-counter secondary capital market and efficiency. And we're going to explore that more in quantitative work in the project.
But expanding, expanding this to the entire distribution of firms, there's a huge amount of reallocation possible. Because the real gains from the real rise in efficiency would be all the low epsilon firms handing their capital to all the high epsilon firms.
Right.
But the extent, the amount of misallocation you get there really depends on your returns to scale. So it sounded like you thought it was a virtue to use constant returns to scale at the level of the individual producer, but you're going to get a lot less misallocation than if you had, you know, severely decreasing returns to scale.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not so sure about that, but I'm willing to consider decreasing returns to scale. That model has some advantages. Maybe there's elements of both in reality. So, you know, there's a lot more to be done on that. What is true is that the search, or rather perhaps the match, both search and matching frictions are key here. You might not find a counterparty and you're sitting there with this capital and your low productivity, or you might have little capital and your high productivity. You don't find a counterparty. You know, some of that is meant to capture in a rough way the specificity issue. You know, I need a new fleet of trucks or something for my firm and I'm in contact with you. You don't have trucks, you've got tractors or something. So there's a lot of misallocation due to the search and matching problems. Still at the margin is going to be some due to the liquidity problem. And policy can affect the liquidity problem where we are taking the search and matching frictions as given. Of course, directed search has a big advantage here. So it's actually, as a theoretical point for this audience, it's not so clear how to do competitive search equilibrium when you get this one-sided market, we're all firms, but there's a distribution of productivity. You know, who are the buyers and who are the sellers? Equilibrium has to sort that out. And it's easy in some special cases, but in general, it's complicated. Let me show you the Euler equations. Consider the case where epsilon is IID.
Randy, just a comment on that. You just have to model participation, then people are going to decide a cutoff on the productivity to be deciding either on the buyer side or the seller side.
I don't think that's a trivial thing to do.
I'm not saying it's impossible,
but I'm saying it's interesting and somewhat non-trivial. You can't do what you would do in a labor market where any firm could post a vacancy and enter that market.
That's true.
You can't do that here because it could be that, you know, I just can't go to the secondary capital market and have all this capital I'm willing to sell. You know, this is a secondary capital market where the sellers are firms with relatively low productivity. So we have to, so, you know, Pissarides has, it's a two-sided market. There's firms and workers. This is a market where everybody could be a buyer or it could be a seller. You have to decide that endogenously. I only have about 5 minutes, so let me move on. I'll just show you the Euler equations quickly. This is a nice way of writing them. These are not steady state, these are dynamic because rho is defined as, you know, with the marginal rate of substitution here. The nominal interest rate, iota, comes from the Fisher equation. For capital, the cost is the interest rate plus the depreciation rate. The benefit is after-tax profit. Profit is B times productivity. Well, you have the expected value of the shock. Then you have the gain in productivity that comes from reallocating in the secondary market. However, it only happens if you meet a counterparty and then you only get some fraction of the gains from trade because of the classic holdup problem. So this is very intuitive, even though it's a bit messy. The demand for real balances, the cost there is the nominal interest rate, or if you prefer the spread between liquid and less liquid assets, And that's the expected value. Again, it's how much capital you can buy at the margin, but you only get some fraction theta because of the bargaining problem. And, you know, these are pretty simple equations, even though the model is kind of complicated. It aggregates really nice. You know, this is not obvious ex ante. It's related to some of Leglis's earlier work. There's a way to define the effective capital stock in terms of after the secondary market closes, there's been a bunch of reallocation, and then we can use that aggregate capital stock to plug it into the production function and get some nice measure of output. These equations will hold even without IID shocks, but there you go. That's why there's a distribution of capital in general. And these markets clear, it's nice to focus on the labor market, the output market, because we can aggregate nicely. Equilibrium is defined, I'm running out of time, but let me say in the obvious way, given paths for policy, equilibrium is a set of paths for capital, liquidity, consumption, employment, and wages, which satisfy the centralized market Euler equations for the two assets, the first order condition for consumption and labor and market clearing. Now, once you have the centralized market sorted out, the decentralized market follows virtually mechanically using the search and bargaining process. I find it interesting that this looks like a macro model from the dark ages pre-rational expectations. The equation, you got an investment equation, liquidity preference, a consumption function, labor demand, the income accounting identity, and the quantity equation, which is up here, just determining the value of price level, if you will. So old-fashioned macroeconomists would like this, but they might not recognize or like the decentralized market, the search and matching component, which is our micro foundations. Steady state, this is where it gets, we haven't, to my mind, figured out the best way to do this. See, what I wanted to do, something we could do in earlier work, we solve the market clearing condition for the wage and plug it into the Euler equations to get two curves, which are in capital real balance space. These are the friggin' ISLM curves. The investment Euler equation is what New Keynesians call the IS curve. The demand for liquidity in a search and matching model is what the old Keynesians called the LM curve. And that was kind of nice because the intersection of ISLM determined the steady state, capital stock and liquidity.
Randy?
Yeah.
If your IS curve is about investment, then it's more Keynesian than the New Keynesian IS curve, which has absolutely no investment anywhere nearby.
There you go. Yeah, great. So this, I mean, as I say, it looks like an old-fangled macro. We can't do it here. Unfortunately, it's a technical detail, but we now are working in BL space, where B is the return or the profitability of capital and L is some normalized notion of liquidity, because it's easy to reduce the whole model to two equations in BL. We haven't figured out quite how to do it I don't think you can do it in KZ space. Of course you can, you know, conceptually you can always reduce a large number of equations by, you know, repeated substitution and get two equations, but we're still working on that. But in BL space, I mean, it's kind of nice. This is, as I said, the undergrad version. I was going to say the undergrad Yale version, thinking that Yale had the best undergraduates, but I thought I shouldn't because it might look like I'm equating Yale with this kind of economics. So I left that out. But basically, it's kind of cute because the nominal interest or monetary policy affects only the LM curve, not the IS curve. If we set the Kiyotaki Moore parameter to 1, then taxes on capital income affects IS, but not LM. So here you can see clearly higher nominal interest rates as a monetary policy shift the LM curve up, increasing B and reducing liquidity. But what we're really interested in, at least to my mind, is not B and L, it's K and Z. So we haven't got a diagram to make that quite as transparent. You know, this just turns out to be, we can still solve for how all the interesting variables depend on the exogenous variables. This is comparing steady states. And you can see, pretty interestingly, it's non-monotone. So here, as we raise the nominal interest rate, at first investment goes down, and then it goes up. So in this, to the left of this cutoff, that's kind of Keynesian. Lowering the nominal interest rate will encourage investment. To the right, it's more like Mundell-Tobin. There, lowering the nominal interest rate will cause people to substitute out of capital and into liquid assets. So you can get different effects depending. What does it depend on? It depends a lot on bargaining power. We know that from earlier work. In this particular, let's call it a calibration, it turns out that, you know, we want to look at things like the R share, that's reallocation over capital expenditure, the P share. The P share, which is partial as a fraction of total capital reallocation, is non-monotone as well. I'm going to briefly skip to the next slide. Here's impulse response functions. Here we model, this is IAD productivity, but we have a stochastic process for this chi haircut parameter and a stochastic process for the money growth rate. And these just show what happens. This is not quite a standard impulse response function. This shocks chi or mu, and then has these things gradually decay back to their, to shock dissipates. So there's this partially internal propagation, but it's also propagation due to the shocks being persistent. But you can see interesting stuff. I mean, here, for example, a quick money injection here is gonna generate temporary blip in output, then it falls and goes back to the steady state. A credit shock, so an increase in pledgeability, shifts up output, which comes down gradually. Productivity, wages, these things have non-monotone impulse responses. I still don't have all the intuition for how this works, but the model has relatively rich dynamics. I'm approximately out of time. That's good. I'm almost out of slides. Here's the version with aggregate productivity shocks. So this is kind of a real business cycle model. By the way, if you shut down the idiosyncratic technology shocks, this is Hansen, because then you don't need the secondary market, right? And if you don't need the secondary market, there's no demand for liquidity. So this reduces exactly to Hansen 85 if there's no idiosyncratic shocks. And I guess you know what those impulse response functions look like from teaching that model, say. Although with the idiosyncratic shocks, you know, we have the reallocation share of capital expenditure, the partial buyouts as a share of reallocation, and the secondary price of capital, all of which don't appear in the textbook RBC model. Persistent shocks, how do you model that? Well, I think this is clever, but I guess to most of you, it's standard stuff. We just say the productivity epsilon has two components, a slowly moving component and an IID component, and let A be an end state Markov chain. Good. So this is just like the obvious generalization of Lagos, right? If there's N different values of this slow moving or persistent productivity component, you're going to get an end state distribution of portfolios. We're working with N equal 2, but you could do whatever you want. So in case you don't understand this, the centralized market in Lagos, right, doesn't get rid of the distribution per se. It gets rid of history dependence, but conditional on this relatively permanent component of productivity, different firms are going to bring different amounts of capital and money. And we're pursuing that. In general, what we see so far is firms with higher persistent components have more capital naturally. They also bring more liquidity. And we still have work to do in that. I'm going to conclude because I'm basically out of time. Not much in this slide, but you know, we're still trying to study models with primary and secondary capital markets. We like that we have two things: constant returns, implying a tendency for stockouts, and liquidity frictions, implying a tendency for cashouts. And you know, the breakdown between stockouts and cashouts depends on all the parameters, including monetary and fiscal policy. And then we have some takeaways in terms of you know, preliminary conclusions. So that's our model. There's a lot more work to do, and I hope, you know, other people find these models interesting. I think it's a new frontier, not in the sense that it's a big deviation from past search models, and not in the sense that no one's thought about this substantive issue, but, you know, bringing to bear the search-based approach, both in terms of bilateral trade, in terms of liquidity, bargaining versus price posting, random matching versus directed search. All these components that we know and love have implications for the macro. And the macro stuff has implications for, you know, fun ways to apply our tools to new issues. And we think it's quite policy relevant. Getting capital into the hands of the people who can use it best, I think, is going to have huge efficiency gains vis-a-vis, you know, the overnight interest rate in the interbank market, which is what the Fed seems to focus on mostly these days, or in normal times anyway. I'm done. Questions? Boy, in the old days, it'd be straight to the pub.
I have a question, Randy. Can I ask you about the very last line on your slide about the nonlinear effect? So I might have missed it, but could you clarify? Are you talking about a distinction between a short run and a long run effect? Or are you talking about nonlinear?
Even if you go to steady state investment, and hence the steady state capital stock, is a nonlinear function of the nominal interest or inflation rates. We have good stories for that. Let me try to tell you one. Increasing the cost of liquidity has two effects on investment. First, if you end up having a low productivity shock, you can try to offload some of your capital in the secondary market. But, you know, your counterparties are likely to have low liquidity because of the high interest rates. So the secondary market's not that lucrative for you if you turn out to be a seller of capital. Hence, you will bring less capital. On the other hand, if you tend to be turn out to be a high productivity firm, well, you can't buy much capital in the secondary market because you didn't want to bring that much liquidity due to the high interest rates. That should encourage you to bring more capital from the primary market. Which of these effects dominate depends on bargaining power, crucially. If you set theta to 1 or 0, you get only one effect and not the other. For theta in between, it's going to depend on, you know, the values of all the endogenous variables. So it turns out you get this nonlinear response to nominal interest rates in investment, even across steady states. That answer your question?
Well, that's part of it. But when you're saying a line like become contractionary in the long run, I'm thinking of sort of a short-term, long-term trade-off.
No, I didn't mean that. I meant as you gradually, okay. I'll say that somebody else typed that line, so I have no idea what they meant. But what my interpretation is, as you start changing nominal interest rates for a while, this is kind of like what Bullard and his co-authors and other people claim they find in some aggregate data. At low inflation rates, inflation is actually, it stimulates the economy. At higher inflation rates, inflation is bad.
I've heard.
That's what this is meant to talk about here.
Okay, thank you.
David Anofato has a question.
Hi, Dave.
Hey, David, you can talk. I already allowed.
You need to unmute yourself.
Okay, before he asks his question, Randy, I have a question about the capital distribution. You said, so you allow persistent productivity shock, but that persistent productivity shock is common across firms?
No. In this version, there's three versions. Individual firms have epsilon. That has two components, a persistent component and an IAD component. Over and above that, we have aggregate shocks.
Right, okay, I see.
And of course, it's interesting here because we want to see how the aggregate shocks, among other things, affect this cross-sectional distribution of portfolios, including capital and liquidity. Let me mention that, you know, these days, firms hold a lot of cash, some firms. I mean, you know, Apple and Google and all these firms, they have tons and tons of liquidity, cash or near cash alternatives. Why do they have it? I don't think it's just because of tax advantages. You know, if you repatriate your cash from foreign countries, you pay taxes. So what, you're going to leave it there forever as a way to avoid the tax? You're going to wait till some tax policy changes? Maybe they like that liquidity because of all the activity.
Well, that may be just partially caused by monetary policy. If you inject so much cash, typically a firm would do is either use the cash to pay off debt or use the cash to buy back the shares.
Yep.
Go ahead.
I have a question related to this. In the model with the persistent idiosyncratic shocks at the firm level, you say that more productive firms, they both invest more, of course, but they also hold more liquidity, if I understood correctly, and vice versa, of course, for the less productive firm. So the basic idea is that if I have persistent shocks, then I'm more likely in the decentralized market to be a buyer of capital. So I'm holding more cash for that, and vice versa. When I'm less productive, I'm more likely to be run into somebody who can deploy it more productively. So I will actually hold less cash because I'm more likely to be a seller. Is that the right way to think about that cross-sectional prediction?
Well, your answer is exactly what I would have said. I'm not 100% sure on that. I think it's going to depend on parameter values and details. I'm not too sure. That's my intuition too, exactly. I'm not sure it's correct because of constant returns. I'm not sure. The best answer I could give is what you gave. And we'll sort that out both quantitatively and theoretically, you know, in the future.
So Randy, can I follow up on Adriano's question? So it seems like with all the linearity and the constant returns, with persistent productivity shocks, wouldn't the high productivity firm just hoard all the capital, all the liquidity, and nobody else hold anything?
Can I jump in there?
Yes.
First of all, we basically index capital and money to the persistent level. So you have aggregate indexed by A. And then you have two effects, as you correctly pointed out. If you're more persistent, you foresee future, you should be able to reallocate more capital, you hold more cash. But at the same time, the partial sales could also increase depending on parameters, because you know that the buyers are going to have a higher surplus due to the persistence. So this, and the counterparties may ask for a higher price. That's why in our simulation, we don't have time to show it here.
That's all. Everything you said is correct. I know Ricardo well. Let me give him his fast answer.
Okay, sorry.
He's right. If there were no idiosyncratic shocks, if I'm higher productivity than you, I'm going to hold all the capital. You're going to hold none. It's constant returns, right? High productivity firms will drive the low productivity firms out of business. It's not true here, because a low productivity firm could get a high epsilon shock, and because the secondary market's frictional, they still might want to bring some capital in case they get a good shock. So the high productivity firms need not drive the low productivity firms out of business in the CM. That's what you were asking, right?
I see. So the idiosyncratic shock in the DM brings in some curvature, I guess.
Yeah,
and also labor is not
everybody. Could we get to David Anofaro's question from the Q&A now?
Yeah, go ahead, David.
So David's question is whether the model provides the same or similar policy prescriptions as the ISLM model.
Well, that's a good question, but the answer is, if you go back to this picture here, as I say, it depends on details, including bargaining power. To the left of this point here, lower nominal interest rates definitely increase investment in capital, like a Keynesian would say. But if you go to higher inflation rates, then it's the opposite. Then you get, again, much more of a Mundell-Tobin effect, where having higher nominal interest rates encourages investment. So the model actually encompasses both possibilities, you know, Keynesian or more classical predictions about monetary policy.
But I think you would want to plot welfare, not investment, to answer that question, because it's not obvious that higher investment is a good.
Right.
Right.
And I would also want to ask you about the short-run effects, because, I mean, Keynesian stabilization policy is traditionally seen as a short-run thing. Is it possible that for different parameters, the short-run effects move in opposite directions?
Yeah. The model's fairly rich. Stan is right. We want to focus on, efficiency and welfare, not investment. But I don't see much use of the ISLM diagram to talk about welfare. So here, we have welfare. If you look at this slide here, where is it? Somewhere we have the consumption equivalent in terms of welfare. It's lower left hand corner. Here's welfare. Higher, it turns out in this specification, the Friedman rule is optimal. So zero nominal rates give the highest welfare in terms of consumption equivalents. Even though, changing nominal interest rates could make capital and investment go up or down, the Friedman rule carries the day.
Have you guys had time to look at something like optimal stabilization policy as it responds?
That's
to
parameter
shocks.
Dependent. The Friedman rule in general is not optimal here, because there could well, as Stan suggested, be over or under investment. And you can work out, at least in earlier work, we figured out, because of bargaining, there's a Hosius-like condition, but then you have the wedges due to capital taxation and the inflation tax wedge. You can work out the policy implications. The Friedman rule in general is not the best policy.
So have you guys had time to look at something like optimal policy responding to shocks in the short term?
Nope. I've been too busy practicing piano. I haven't had time to look at that. But that's a good question.
Could I ask, how long are the periods in your, how long do you think the periods are?
What if I said, according to the calibration, it looks like it's annual, but maybe a quarter might be better, 3 months.
The quarterly data is very noisy. The way they do encompass that is, it's non-audit and usually it's year to year. So the first quarter, you might have one quarter, the second quarter, you have first quarter and second quarter and so on. The yearly data is cleaner.
I guess the question is, John's question presumably is about the economics of the frequency, not what the data forces us to choose.
Right. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, the period length is totally flexible in terms of the model. The conceptual question is, if I'm hit with productivity in the short run, I might want to buy some used capital. In the long run, in principle, I might just build a new factory. And the question is, what's the short run and long run in the model correspond to? I don't have a good feel for that, but.
Am I right in thinking in the centralized market, there can be a complete reshuffle?
Yes.
An efficient reshuffle of capital. So
yes.
If these centralized markets happened very frequently, then we'd be talking about an inefficiency that doesn't last long.
If you have capital misallocated for 3 months, that could be a relatively serious efficiency issue. If it's overnight, I don't know. But
yeah,
the longer you have to wait between, as you say, the centralized market where you can reshuffle things and start with a clean slate, the longer you have to wait, the more the inefficiency will rear its ugly head. Now, this is more so in models without a centralized market. Much of the literature on capital reallocation hits firms with shocks and they have to wait to the next centralized market to react. At least we give these guys the possibility of retrading in the intermediate period. So adding the secondary market to the framework decreases the inefficiencies.
Well, distantly related, I have a compliment to this kind of framework though.
You're gonna give me a compliment? That's rare. Yeah.
I mean, relative to the annual uses of these such models for capital relocation, like what we did or I did in these other models, this kind of model, I think, opens the door to some other interesting questions. For example, why is the intermediation so rare in this capital relocation market? I mean, we see it happening in the housing market. Gradually, companies
very gradually.
Yeah, but you know, firms like Zillow are exactly doing that intermediation.
Yeah, that's very new. I used to say the biggest puzzle for me in economics was why there's no middlemen in the housing market. Because the biggest, a major component of risk in one's life is when you have to buy and sell your house, which you do infrequently, and it's a huge component of your wealth. And there's so much price dispersion in the housing market. It's a big puzzle why there's not more intermediation. I guess for capital, there is some intermediation. I mean, in commercial real estate, I don't know if it's more or less than there is in housing. I guess in the airplane market, there is some intermediation. I think middlemen will buy some planes, put them, I think, somewhere in Arizona, and then try to sell them. So there's some. You know, I don't have a good answer. You can always, you know, board out adverse selection, but I'm not sure that's the end of the story.
Well, you know, with this centralized market, you do actually, I think it's probably more, it's easier to model that intermediation process.
Right.
That's the compliment.
Right, no good, because right, if you have a Walrasian model, there's no role for middlemen, whereas in a over-the-counter market, you know, people in this participating in the seminar understand the role of middlemen in the over-the-counter market. So let me add something. We could do this with no money, right? You're just, you know, give people a little bit more credit, but make it not perfect credit. Money and middlemen are two institutions which help mitigate or ameliorate the trading frictions. We're focusing on money here. Because credit's not perfect, people bring liquid assets to the decentralized market. So money is an institution that helps against the frictions. Middlemen are another institution which would help against the frictions. Whether money and middlemen are substitutes or complements, that depends on how you model it. So I agree with you very much.
But in general, it's going back to the very first sentence you said, these two things actually interact. If you do have a middleman, then liquidity increases, then it may actually stimulate the people participating.
Absolutely. Yep, absolutely. I agree with that.
Sorry.
No, John, go ahead.
Can I just push ahead a bit further down this road of what's the length of the period? So suppose it was a quarter. So it's for 3 months, people have to meet each other randomly in order to do business. But then they know that after 3 months, there's going to be a centralized market where everything can be perfectly reshuffled. That's the model. In practice, you know, there is no centralized market for idiosyncratic capital.
Right.
It's always decentralized. So what's the role of the centralized market? I think I might be able to see the role of it in the model, but at a sort of deeper level, why bother having the centralized market in the framework at all?
Well, I mean, Lagos could answer that. It was his idea, but it harnesses the distribution of portfolios in the population. They could meet in decentralized markets for a while. What you're holding in terms of capital and liquid assets will depend on your trading history. So you somehow got to work out that endogenous distribution of portfolios. When people hit the centralized market, they start again, so it's much easier to solve.
But
having said that, we can add frictions to the centralized market too.
Yeah, so that would be a natural way to proceed. Then I think. Currently, you're making.
It's a funny question coming from John, because he says we have both, you know, search markets and Walrasian markets, and of course the real world is always search. But John's paper is it's only Walrasian. He doesn't have a search market. So we could put some Kiyotaki-Moore or whatever kind of frictions you want in the CM. You can overlay that with what we have now.
Then you will lose attractability to the CM.
We will, but, you know, it's not the end of the world. Right? Once you're going to go to the computer, we could handle that.
Could you have continuously operating centralized markets for some assets?
Yeah, you can.
Continuously operating and as it were, continuously operating, if that's the right word, of decentralized markets too. But
yeah.
there's no jerky backwards and forwards between them. They're both happening.
Yeah. Let me mention something just because this is a search and matching workshop. So these kind of models I find nice because in so many models, so much depends on the length of the period. So here you see, adjusting beta kind of pins down conceptually whether it's a year or a month. And you might say, as you go from the yearly model to the monthly model, you can reallocate your capital so quickly it doesn't matter. Well, if you go to higher period lengths but reduce the arrival rate, it's a wash. You see? So I can have markets meeting very frequently, but the probability of finding a counterparty could be going down. So things are less dependent here on the length of the period.
But I thought the centralized market, everything.
Yeah. No, I was gonna add the caveat that once you get to the centralized market.
If the centralized market happened every night or every day or something, then the inefficiencies associated with the intra-day inefficiencies would be peanuts, probably.
Well, that's a special case because, let's go back to this timeline. You know, the primary market is Walrasian. The secondary market, we've built in search, matching, bargaining, and liquidity frictions. We can take out all of those things. Our secondary market could be Walrasian with perfect credit. So we have a special case, only centralized markets in that terminology. We wanted to add in a little bit of search, matching, bargaining, and liquidity, so we did it here. But right, you could take frictions out of the secondary market and get what you're talking about. Now, you know, we could do that. We think it's a good idea to have some frictions in there. Like, for example, this, you can get rid of the search friction and even get rid of the liquidity problem. The bargaining is still going to be highly relevant here. The original descriptions of holdup problems come from the capital, the IO literature, where I want to buy some of your capital. You're going to give me a bad deal on it because you have high bargaining power. So you can parse out different frictions here. Doesn't have to be search and matching. Doesn't have to be liquidity. Could be all bargaining. You could get rid of bargaining by putting in Walrasian pricing and maintain the liquidity friction. So, you know, this secondary market can be more or less decentralized depending on how you want to model it. And as I think Francesco said, you can add more frictions to the so-called centralized market too. We happen to take the extreme example here where the primary market is totally frictionless and the secondary market, you know, is full of frictions, but you can do different versions.
So Randy, can I follow up on your answer to John, just to emphasize?
Please.
So in the old days, we used to think the probability of trading was really important and the difference between primary and secondary, what you call here, had to do with whether it's everybody trading or not. Now we know that the parameter that matters is alpha times theta.
Yeah.
It's just you could just tell the whole story about market power. And sometimes, you know, you're on the wrong side of the market power, and sometimes you're in a good side, and that could be the CMDM structure.
Let me just say, the theorem's proof is easy. The arrival rate shows up multiplied by the bargaining power in both the Euler equations. So that's where I learned that from Lagos Rashita. With Kalai bargaining especially, it's very clear. Okay, go ahead, Ricardo.
Yeah, so basically all we ever do could just be about market power and markups, never talking about how frequently you trade, how likely you are to find a counterparty. So it doesn't have to be about search. In some contexts, it's very realistic to be about search as well. But and the other answer I found convincing from you is, you know, in some sense, the trick of the CM, if you want to harness the distribution, you'd worry if it would kind of like bias results in your favor. But here, it makes a reallocation channel less important. So in some sense, if you're loaded against you. Now you could imagine with a bit more of computer work, you could just assume that the capital only trades in the DM and everything else trades in the CM. So then you just have one dimension of heterogeneity to keep track of. So, you know, you could use a trick asset by asset as you see fit, you know, and presumably you guys could do that if you wanted.
Yeah, yep. that's what I was asking for, really. Yeah. There is no moment, no change of regime between CM and DM, but just different markets are in one or the other category, but permanently in those categories.
Yeah.
I like the
version of continuous time, but continuous time generates some complications, but Pierre Olivier Weil and Guillaume Rocheteau and others have continuous time versions of these things. Williamson has one too. In those, Williamson's, I understand the best. There's a centralized market that's always open, but there's some things you might want to buy, you get kicked over to a search and matching market because that's where it's traded. I mean, think about drugs and prostitution as being obvious examples, which are traded in highly decentralized cash markets. You know, there's still a Walrasian market open at the same time, but you don't want a loaf of bread. You want something more illicit. You can do something like that here. There's a continuous Walrasian market, but there is an over-the-counter market for used capital. If you look at the literature, go back to the slide 2 here. You know, observations in the literature, there's price dispersion in the secondhand capital market. There is the duration of time till you trade is kind of long and certainly random. It seems to be affected by market tightness. Forcing those observations into a Walrasian market, I don't think is very natural. So all these observations suggest that search is relevant in these markets.
I just wanted to emphasize a different aspect, which would lead you to interpret the model at a lower frequency, I think, which is one difference, and this is certainly in our work, one difference between reallocation and new investment is how like new investment, typically we think of there's one year time to build or some time to build, whereas reallocation, you can reallocate the asset more quickly. This is actually happening in some sense in this model. But this would tell you that to think about the frequency of these two markets, you might want to think much at lower frequencies. So that certainly was my interpretation. That would be my interpretation.
Much of my leisure time these days is spent looking at the television about housing markets and people, just what you say. You can buy a house on the secondary market. There is search, matching, bargaining, liquidity issues. You can build a house. The time to build could be about a year. So that's got to be the same for factories, right? So I agree with that.
They just cut it that way. It's usually more than a year.
Yep. There's always delays. Now, having said that, buying a house also involves some, you know, an existing house. You had to move in and everything else. Buying a factory is not totally timeless. There is some time to retool. But buying
It's not black and white. I agree.
Right.
I mean, one deep difference between secondhand and new stuff is that new stuff can be designed to your tastes, whereas the secondhand stuff, you buy it warts and all, and you have to spend serious resources to convert it into your own idiosyncratic use.
This is the notion of specificity. Like when Kiyotaki had to take Wright off of his CV and replace it with more, you see? Bad example. When you buy a fleet of trucks, you got to repaint with your name on them. You got to, the secondary stuff, you know, it's already been built to certain specifications. It may not be perfect. I agree. That's a big friction.
I'd love to just check the answer to my first question a long time ago, which is when stuff, if I buy a restaurant, but the restaurant's still producing the same food, same clients, maybe the same chef. But does that constitute a reallocation of the restaurant? I get a feeling in the data it is, but in practice, not much has happened.
I'm not an expert on this, but I think the entrepreneurial ability differs across people. In the restaurant business, what happens a lot is like the chef always wants to have his own restaurant, opens a restaurant. Turns out he's good at cooking, he's not good at business. So somebody else comes in and buys him out. It's the same cooks, waitresses, food, but new ownership. But ownership could be an important input because he has entrepreneurial ability. Also, the chef may realize he doesn't like hiring and firing and doing the books. He'd rather spend time in the kitchen. So, you know, new ownership there actually is, he just doesn't like doing that. Putting a new owner in is, in some sense, a reallocation of entrepreneurial ability. But I'm not an expert in this. That's just a little anecdote.
But that's exactly our interpretation. So in Iceberg Rampini, we argued that the asset is reallocated, like the asset with organization capital and physical capital, the entire firm is reallocated if it goes to a new controlling owner. And the controlling owner could, of course, choose, at least for parts of the business, to continue to operate them similarly. but it could also choose not to. And I think that's where the, essentially the productivity of the controlling owner is what's is in our interpretation, at least what's critical. And so that's the sense in which a merger, even if the firm continues to operate, reallocates it. But it's, I mean, again, it's not black and white, and this, it's a very good question.
I have a suggestion for future research, which I don't want to do myself, but somebody might take it up. So this liquidity problem and the, you know, the Kiyotaki Moore credit friction, you know, one way around that potentially is I'm not going to buy your restaurant or your capital. We're just going to become partners. That's a way of relaxing these frictions. But then it introduces all the agency problems with partnerships. So, you know, here, if inflation's high, firms are going to be illiquid. They won't buy capital. That deal just doesn't go through, or it goes through just a tiny bit of it. So let them form partnerships. The deal will go through, but the outcome's going to be inefficient due to agency problems. And that's just another way to think about all these issues. I think that's a good idea for a project.
Okay, that seems like a really great place to end it. So thank you, Randy, and co-authors for coming to present today. Thank you all the panelists for coming. It was a great discussion. We'll end the recording now. You're free to kind of hang out and continue to chat, though. So thanks,
hey,
everyone, for being here.
That expression, this is the most fun I've ever had with my clothes on. Well, you don't even know if I have my clothes on.
All right, ending the recording.
I have to go, my co-author.